folks, if you would please take your seats, we're going to begin shortly. Thank you.
a real honor to welcome you all to this very special time as we honor Tom's service to our country. He didn't really want to be called chief, but we can do that, can't we? Because he's not with us anymore, so he can't complain about it if we call him chief. But he certainly was that, and we want to honor his memory in a very special way. Would you stand with me? Are we ready back there to bring the urn in?
Honor Guard uniform personnel, present arms. Order arms. Color Guard ceremonial about face. Over.
Please remain standing as we read scripture this morning or this afternoon. Lord, you have been our dwelling place throughout all generations, even before the mountains were born, and you brought forth the earth and the world from everlasting to everlasting. You are God. For you turn men back to dust, saying, return to dust, O sons of men. For 1,000 years in your sight are like a day that has just gone by, or like a watch in the night. For you sweep men away in the sleep of death. They are like the new grass. In the morning it springs up new, but by evening it is dry and withered. Our days pass away, and we finish our years with a moan. The length of our days is 70 years, or 80 if we have the strength, or a little bit more to be appropriate for our time today. And yet those years go by so quickly, and soon we fly away. And then he gives us some good advice in the 12th verse when he says, so teach us to number our days, to recognize how few they really are. Help us to spend them as we should. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, how grateful we are for men like Tom who have spent their time and energy in making a difference in the world, in the Sheriff's Department and in EMS and in volcano rescue and all that surrounds that, in training young men and women to serve our country and in saving life and property. And we're grateful for his fingerprints that have been left here in the north part of our county, which are so very much needed. We pray that this service would be a real tribute to him and to those who have served. Thank you for each one who has taken time out of a day that they could be doing other things. And we're grateful for a beautiful weather that you've provided for us today as well. And so we ask for your comfort, your strength, in the remaining time, we pray in your name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. The obituary, by the way, there still are seats available here for any of those that would like to find a seat. We'd like to provide that for you as well. Thomas Roy McDowell, December 6, 1940, to October 5th of this year. Thomas Ray McDowell slipped quietly from this earth on Wednesday, October 5th, to be with his Heavenly Father. His wife of 58 years, Diane, and by the way, Diane, we honor you. Being married to a EMS guy isn't all it's cracked to be. Did you know that when you got married to him? No. Well, my wife would understand what you're talking about. Being gone in the middle of the night, never know when he's going to come back, and she even had to take care of a new calf one time when I was gone, and that's the way it worked out. She survives Tom and his children, Tammy McDowell of Yakult, David Barry of Arizona, Thomas and Emily of Battleground, and grandsons Cougar McDowell, Cody, Matthew, Hunter, Bosca, Brad, and Mitchell Hendricks. Tom was born December 6, 1940 in Chicago, Illinois, to Roy and Ruth McDowell. His family moved to Hillsboro, Oregon, where he grew up. Tom graduated from Washington State University, where he obtained a bachelor's and master's degree in police science and administration. He began his career in law enforcement in Washington County while still in college. Upon graduation, he worked for Multnomah County Sheriff's Office, then back to Washington County Sheriff's Office, where he rose to Chief of Detectives. He left his position in Washington County to become the first director of the Idaho State Police Officers Standards and Training Academy in Pocatello, Idaho. After establishing that program, he returned to law enforcement as an undersheriff in the Clark County Sheriff's Office. Tom's career path changed after moving to Yakult. He realized Clark County residents were in need of emergency medical services. Residents had to wait an hour or longer for ambulance to come for Vancouver. By the way, the Columbian did a article on Tom and said that he had come and noticed a chicken coop that was on fire, and the thing actually burned to the ground before any fire department was able to come out. And he decided, I got to do something about this. And so it was a chicken coop that was his calling. I don't know if that's stretching it, but I thought that was an interesting little part of it. Also part of rural Clark County was without fire services. There we go. With the help of community members and dedicated volunteers, Tom revitalized the Yakult Fire Department and worked to officially form Clark County Fire District number 13. I'm just curious, how many here were trained under Tom? Can you stand? Just stand wherever you're at. I even took first responder at here in Yakult way back when. Thank you so much. Boy, that's amazing to see all, and you're in various departments and various places. That's quite something. Again, with the support of the community and dedicated volunteers, he founded North County Emergency Medical Service, an agency that grew to serve a large part of North Clark County, now serves an area of approximately 1,000 square miles. After the eruption of Mount St. Helens, North County EMS began providing medical services to the crews of timber salvage operators working around the mountain. And by the way, as I was coming up 503, how many of you came up 503 today? Did you see the mountain? I think God was very gracious in providing that beautiful, beautiful view of the mountain there. When visitors began traveling to the volcano, Tom started the volcano rescue team. How many of you are on the volcano rescue team? Can I see? Oh my goodness, yes, great. You will never need to rescue me off that mountain. I just want you to know that. Tom started the volcano rescue team to find and rescue lost and injured hikers, climbers, and visitors. Over the past 40 plus years, thousands of men and women have served with NCEMS, YFD, CCFD, number 13, and the VTR. Tom had the ability to see the good in people, and even when they didn't see it in themselves, and over the course of his lifetime encouraged hundreds of people into career service, including firefighting, emergency medicine, law enforcement, medicine, and other career services. He felt the citizens of North Clark County were the finest anywhere, and he was proud to serve this community. His family is comforted by the outpouring of love and support they have received from the community and in knowing he made a difference in so many people's lives. Donations in his memory can be made to the North County North Country Emergency Medical Service, the Volcano Rescue Team, or the Alzheimer's Association. By the way, you each have in your folder was this guest register. You can put your name and address there and some thoughts that you might want to put down. A little later on in the service, we're going to give you an opportunity to share some memories verbally, but not everybody finds that easy to do and would rather write some things down. The family will find that to be a real treasure in years to come as well. We're going to now have a video. We're going to have the Lord's Prayer. By the way, I just found out yesterday that the fellow who was supposed to fill in at my church got COVID, and so he called me and said, "You're next on the list." And I'm preaching a sermon on the Lord's Prayer tomorrow. So if we have room for some of you, but nonetheless, we should know this by heart. Let's pray the Lord's Prayer together, shall we? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Thank you so much. We're going to now have the video presentation that has been put together with some pictures of Tom and the involvement he had.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. On my shoulders makes me happy. Sunshine in my eyes can make me cry. Sunshine on the water looks so lovely. Sunshine almost always makes me crystal clear ocean to ride on the crest of a wild raging storm, to work in the service of life and the living in search of the answers to questions unknown, to be part of the movement, part of the growing, part of beginning to understand. Rocky Mountain High,
Colorado.
Rocky Mountain High, Colorado.
Once I was 7 years old, my mama told me, go make yourself some friends or you'll be lonely. Once I was 7 years old, it was a big, big world, but we thought we were bigger, pushing each other to the limits. We were learning quicker, by 11 smoking herb and drinking burning liquor. Never rich, so we were out to make that steady figure. Once I was 11 years old, my daddy told me, go get yourself a wife or you'll be lonely. Once I was 11 years old.
I fall. troubles come and my heart burdened be, then I am still and wait here in the silence until you come and sing a while with me. You raise me up so stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I'm on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can.
My heart beating, 'cause you are the reason I'm losing my sleep. Please come back now. There goes my mind racing, and you are the reason that I'm still breathing. I'm hopeless now. I'd climb every mountain and swim every ocean just to be with you and fix what I've broken. Oh, 'cause I need you to see that you the reason.
Almost heaven, West Virginia, Blue Ridge Mountains, Shenandoah River. Life is old there, older than the trees, younger than the mountains, growing like a breeze. Country roads, take me home to the place I belong. West Virginia, mountain mama, take me home, country roads. Gather round her, miner's lady, stranger to blue water. Dark and dusty, painted on the sky, misty taste of moonshine, teardrop in my eye. Country roads, take me home to the place. But now I see.
blind, but now I see.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name's Steve Bregman. If you take a look at the program, you'll see that Ron Stewart was supposed to be speaking at this point. But if there's one thing I think that Tom taught all of us, it's plan for the unexpected and have a backup plan. And so today, I'm that backup plan. Ron couldn't be here due to some unforeseen circumstances. But he passed on something that he wanted read today, and so I'm going to read that right now. Dear friends, it is fitting that we're having this service on Veterans Day weekend, because this holiday is about honoring those who have served. And Tom McDowell surely needs to be honored for his service to North Clark County. He worked in all areas of EMS. Some people are involved in EMS, but Tom lived EMS. When I first met Tom 22 years ago, I was living in a suburb of Tacoma, and I was asked to do some training for North Country. So I came to scout it out. I'd never even heard of the town of Yakult. And when I drove into this little town in the middle of nowhere, I thought, what have I got myself into? However, I was very impressed with Tom and NCMS. Shortly thereafter, I was offered a job to work at North Country. So I relocated my family, moving into the town of Yakult, where we became an active part of this great community, and in turn, made lifelong friends. I learned a lot from Tom, who always led by example. He was a man who truly loved making a difference. His dedication, professionalism, and work ethic in life touched everyone he met. There are hundreds of first responders and thousands of community members spread across the country that have been touched by Tom's exemplary life. He was a true hero, and he dedicated his life to saving lives, protecting the community, and the development of future leaders in public safety. I'm very blessed to have been part of his legacy. The other day, my wife and I were going through the antique shops in Kalama, where I saw something that brought Tom to mind. It was a small statue figure with a bald eagle soaring in the air. And on the base of the plaque, there was a Bible verse. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and never grow weary. Their mind will be sharpened, and when they walk, it will not be faint. Tom will always be remembered in our hearts because of his lifelong commitment to his family, friends, and community. God bless Tom's friends and family. Sincerely, Ron Stewart. We just had a wonderful visual tribute to Tom. Thank you, Yuri, and everyone else that contributed in putting that together. At this point, we'd like to open it up to going from the visual to the verbal, to share stories and memories. And so with that, I know a couple people have approached me to speak. I'll start with a few of them, and then we'll open it up to anybody else that has stories that they would like to pass on. So Larry, would you like to come up?
Thank you very much. My name is Larry Plott. I'm from Idaho, and you've heard of the Idaho Post Academy. That's where I first met Tom. I had 12 years as an Idaho State Patrolman, and I was looking to have a change. So I heard that they were having a board meeting up at Pocatello, and that they were looking for an assistant. So I thought, well, I'll go up there and see what that's all about. And, you know, I was kind of looking for a job that would really be meaningful and busy. Well, I met Tom McDowell in 1969. He was sitting on the board with his arms crossed, drilling me, and enjoying seeing me squirm. Does that sound normal? They were seeking to fill the training coordinator position for the newly established Post Academy. He had long sideburns, cowboy boots, bell-bottom plaid pants. He was dissecting every word that I spoke and seemed to be enjoying seeing me struggle. Knowing I had blown it completely, I was ready to pack my bags and walk out. That's when they said, "Larry, don't leave yet. We might want to talk to you some more." That's when Tom McDowell asked me, "Larry, do you like to work a lot of extra hours with no extra pay?" He said, "We plan to have 5 4-week basic sessions the first year with 30 to 35 officers each, plus a few in-service and certified instructor schools." I later learned that the decision was between me and an older officer, and Tom thought he might have trouble keeping up with such a fast pace and a workload. In other words, he was attempting to find someone else close to his age to match his energy, and that was impossible. The staff would be made up of 3 people: Director McDowell, the secretary, and the training coordinator. That was it. The budget was a whopping $45,000. If you needed equipment, it had to be borrowed from one of the departments. The dorm and the classroom would be provided by Idaho State University. After being hired, Tom gave me my assignment. "You run the academy operations, and I will focus on the administrative side." Both were monumental jobs, as neither of us had ever run an academy. The paperwork preceding an academy and following was voluminous. There was no internet to browse for ideas such as sample policies and procedures or lesson plans. Tom could type 85 words a minute on an old electric typewriter and not make any mistakes. He typed up all the stencils. Now, a stencil is something that probably not too many people have seen in this room, but it had to be perfect without any errors on it, and that was put on an old drum, and you ran it manually. That was my job. And if you didn't get ink on you, you were pretty lucky. Most of the time, it had a lot of ink on you. There was several times that I thought, "What have I gotten into?" After a day in the office, I had trouble finding my car in the parking lot. The curriculum calls for 220 hours of training in 4 weeks. If you do the math, that's 55 hours a week. The longer I worked for Tom, I realized he was a workaholic and had a brilliant mind. He had great skills for putting things down on paper. He loved to bring people together for a cause. His mind was photographic, as he never seemed to forget things that he had gleaned from others or items he read. He had a great sense of humor and was very self-assured. He sometimes would say things just to get your reaction, almost to the point of pissing you off. And then he would laugh. He was a great mentor, boss, friend, and colleague. It was a great highlight when Post involved all past directors to the 50-year reunion there in Boise, Idaho. Tom and his wife, Diane, both were in attendance. The senior police executives who hired Tom McDowell in December of 1969 as their first director for the Idaho Police Academy certainly made the right decision, as Tom was able to put that academy on a foundation that has spanned over 50 years and still is one of the best today in the nation. Thank you very much. Very honored to be here. I miss Tom a lot. He was a very, somebody said, how many people in here have been trained by him? I was trained every day right under him. Thank you very much.
Serge?
It was a little hard for me to write this, so I'm just going to read it. Sorry for my public speaking abilities. Tom told me that the greatest joy in life is making others happy and helping others succeed. This has always stuck with me because Tom lived this principle daily his whole life. My name is Serge Evermenko. I had the joy and blessing of calling Tom my friend for 11 years. I met Tom when I was just a 17-year-old kid. I had a dream, but no real direction to achieving my dream. Tom took me under his wing and started providing me that direction. Step by step, he would guide me. He seemed to believe in me and my dream career more than I did in myself. He set a fire in me and made me believe that my dreams are achievable. Tom was a great example and role model for me to follow and learn from. I grew up in a broken home and never had a good father teach me how to be a man, and that lack showed itself sometimes, and I was painfully aware of it. Tom filled that role for me. He chatted with me almost daily. He kept me out of trouble and helped me grow into a man by his example and wisdom. After my mother, Tom was the most impactful person in my life. I am by far not the only young man or woman who Tom mentored and raised. As we have already heard and will hear today, there are many of us. We were called the Tom boys. Some of us Tom literally picked up off the street and out of a destructive life of crime and drugs. Tom had a way of taking young kids and slowly developing us with increasing responsibilities and jobs. From working in North Country and Fire District 13 or the Volcano Rescue Team, and taking us in wildfires with a lot of Diane's cookies. Tom had never-ending jobs for us, each step progressively pushing us beyond our comfort zones, stimulating growth and building life and career confidence in us. Sometimes we'd mess up, and Tom always had such a calm demeanor, gently correcting us and steering us back on track. In 11 years, I have only seen Tom upset at me twice. First time was when we were working the Pine Creek Station and we had our radios turned down, missing some routine traffic from Yakult. Tom got in his rig and had to drive to us for 1 hour. And after he came in with tires screeching, and after a stern earful, he told us this will never happen again, or he will come back and shove the radios where the sun don't shine. And then he says, sideways. We knew he meant it. Everyone that knows how sacred radio comms were to Tom. Second time was when I was being stupid and wrecked an almost brand new snowmobile belonging to the Volcano Rescue Team. I thought Tom was going to kill me. But instead, next day, he very grudgingly rewarded me with a helicopter ride to go fetch the machine. saying I was the only one who knew exactly where it's at. Tom would always go to bat for us. He was all about second and third chances. At 17, I was a piece of work. And I felt like I didn't deserve his kind mentorship and attention. His genuine care for others, generosity and love for helping people seemed to have no end. Even though Tom was old enough to be my grandfather, I felt no generational barriers whatsoever. His ability to relate to and mentor young little boys and girls and turn them into men and women seems very extraordinary to me. One thing I will always remember about Tom is his love and pride for his family. He always told me how lucky he was to have such a long and loving marriage with Diane. I was always amazed at how Tom and Diane were able to raise three wonderful children of their own, and then together help so many other young people in need of direction and a mentor. People like me and many others present here today. My hope is to be able to have at least 10% as much positive impact on this world as Tom did. That will be a life very well lived. Tom will forever be so dear to my heart, and his legacy will have immeasurable reach through all of us who he inspired with his life of selfless service, generosity, and kindness. I love you, Tom, and I miss you like crazy.
Good afternoon. People know me as Deb Ward. I'm a former commander of the Oregon Air National Guard. Before that, the commander of the fighter wing of Portland. Moved over, as we said, jumped the ditch in 1975 and settled in the suburbs of Yakult. I got to know Tom. Our wives were serving tea at the Pomeroy House and the Pomeroy Living Farm, and we became acquainted that way. Our daughters were in elementary school, high school together, still maintain as good friends and so on. Many years ago, Tom asked me if I would become a member of the North Country EMS board. And it was highly honored to be asked that, because it had already had a reputation that Tom had built up. And he had some things that he did that were identical to what we did in the military, and that is build quality with everything, learn all the time, always be making improvements, have a disciplined force, and be reliable. And it was my first opportunity to have a civilian position, being in a civilian position on that board, governing position. And I served as the vice chairman of that board for many years. As I say, you can't always tell what's going to happen in there. But when Tom retired as for the fire department, the chief of the fire department and EMS, somehow by default, I ended up being the board representative and acknowledging the great service that Tom provided to the community. All those attributes that he had, all those things that he did for the community, are the same things that we had in the military. The senior enlisted rank is Chief Master Sergeant. And the Chief Master Sergeants took our enlisted people, trained them, taught them the responsibilities that we had, life and death issues that we were responsible for. And Tom really deserved that designation as chief. Thank you.
My name is Mike Williams. I'm on the volcano rescue team. My father, Dennis, had the privilege of serving under Tom and with Tom in public safety in this county for Tom's first 20 years in this county. And I had the privilege of serving under Tom the last 20 years. I want to share a fun story. We all have a lot of fun memories with Tom. In my early years on the rescue team, we had a significant traumatic injury up at Lower Falls. And I was the first one to get to the station. And Tom said, okay, you get to take the rescue up. And he said, I want you to go code 2.5. What in the world is code 2.5? So I thought, well, to be conservative, we're just gonna drive the speed limit, maybe turn the lights on once in a while, get somebody out of the way. My last words to him as we pulled out were, I'm sure I'll see you behind me in a few minutes. And he said, I doubt that. We got to Cougar, and there's Tom flying right up on my tail. Next thing I heard on the radio was, somebody's driving like a grandma. So I responded back and said, would you like me to pick it up? He said, that sounds like a good idea. So I turned the lights and siren on and took off out of town, and he was right on my tail the whole way. A couple miles down the road, I got back on the radio and said, would you like me to pull over at the next wide spot? He said, that sounds like a good idea. Got up to Lower Falls. Tom had already made access to the patient down at the river, had a plan in place, and was coordinating the whole effort before he even got to the parking lot. We will always remember Tom as someone who drove fast, loved people, and got stuff done.
I'd like to continue with some stories, so if anybody else would like to come up, please feel free to come up, or if need be, I can bring a microphone over.
Try and keep my composure here. Some of you know me. A lot of you probably don't. I first came to know Tom in the 1980s. I'm Ken Netzel. I was one of the first paramedics to come to know him. He has had, over the years, the most impact in my life. He taught me many, many things. He helped me to do many, many things. I had the honor of working with him in developing some of the rescue teams that he has. So many stories, too many to tell. Each and every one of you have significant stories about Tom. There's a whole list of adjectives that can define Tom. Out of that whole list, I tried to come up with one. The one that I could come up with is a magician. He didn't make any difference if he was working with people with radios, with ambulances, with fire apparatus, the station, anything that Tom wanted to do, he was able to pull the rabbit out of a hat and do it. He was fantastic, magnificent. And I will always remember Tom. He'll always be a part of me. I'm sorry I get so emotional. But he had a great impact on my life, and I'll never forget Tom.
Well, we have heard from the older generation. We've heard from some of the younger generation, but we haven't heard from a woman yet about this extraordinary man. Many years ago, I had a friend, and he told me that you judge success by the impact that you have, and that the impact survives you. You build an organization, and when you retire, it continues to flourish and thrive. And what made Tom so unique is he has built many organizations. All of them have succeeded. Many of them never would have been built to the extraordinary service they provide without him, but they all can continue after he's gone. And that makes him admirable and one of the people I admire most that I have ever met. Now to provide a little humor for the man, the real man that he is. My husband is a construction worker, big guy, powerful guy, perfect recruit for the volcano rescue team. And here I am, 5'2". I think they allowed me to test because they wanted my husband. Then when Tom interviewed me, I was in my mid-40s at the time. He asked me, after reading my resume, and I have an Ivy League education, he asked me if I could take orders from a 22-year-old who didn't know anything. I was being tested. I understood that. I said, yes, as long as they're not trying to kill me or themselves, I will do it their way. And so I did become part of the team. My first 8 missions, I sat outside his office. I wasn't deployed. I don't know why. I tried not to take it personally. Shortly thereafter, he began to put me out there in the field. And I think that we grew to respect and work well with each other over time. I was between jobs for a couple of years, showed up at every mission, and loved working with him. You can never go without a story that includes Diane's cookies. They were legendary. He always had some in the car. It was the first at the office when a call came in, and we took off to Middle Falls in his car. If you think it's terrifying having him on your tail, it's even more terrifying to be in the car. We slid around every corner, barely not kissing the guardrails on every corner. Everything in the back seat, including me and the cookies, went flying everywhere. We arrive on scene. Now I need to be productive in hoping that I am not suffering too much from motion sickness. And all the while, Tom's got 2 radios and a cell phone going at the same time. So I don't know how we got there in one piece, but we did. But I always loved working with Tom. I loved the challenge that he would always put in front of you. He tested you piece by piece, and as you proved your mettle, it didn't matter if you were a big guy or a little old lady, he found a way to use you effectively. and built organizations that will last and be known for their excellence long after he is gone.
Hello, my name is Travis Winston, and I got started up here in October of 1989. I was a sophomore in high school, and I had just met my mom's cousin who had just started his career in the Tucson Fire Department. He was telling me some stories about being a firefighter, paramedic, and I thought, wow, that sounds pretty cool. So I was in speech class sophomore year, and I said that I wanted to be a firefighter, paramedic, and I met a guy in class who was older than me named Jimmy Robertson, and he had been involved up here already in the community. So he said, you should go check out the open house. It's happening like next week or something. And I had just gotten my driver's license. So I was like, hey, this works out pretty good. And at the same time, I had had a job at the grocery store in Battleground. And I'll admit this to all of you. This is like embarrassing. It's the only job I ever got fired from. I didn't tell Tom. I got fired for drinking a chocolate milk in the cooler. So that's pilferage. So I went to the open house, and of course I met Tom, and they had the slideshow going, they had the VRT, they had the ambulances, the fire trucks. It was like, why would you not want to join, you know? This seems awesome. So he's like, so you're interested? Do you want to join? And I was like, well, yeah, this seems great. This is right up my alley. This is what I want to do. And he's like, well, do you have a job? And I'm like, no. He's like, do you have a driver's license? I'm like, I just got it last week. And he's like, well, do you want a job? And I'm like, well, sure, what is it? And he's like, show up on Monday. So I had the great privilege to work at the fire station through my high school days. I would call up to the station and Alice would answer the phone and she'd give me my list of chores or where I needed to go run and grab stuff. So I'd go run the errands and Alice would never say goodbye on the phone. That was the thing. We could never get Alice Garrison to say goodbye. She would just hang up the phone. Before I could actually roll on some calls, I had to get my medical first responder some training done, and it was just such an awesome opportunity. And then at the same time, I learned how to clean really well. Alice would check my cleaning, made sure everything was done right. I polished the windows with newspaper. That's something I learned from Alice as well. And to always leave the crawler in the box of donuts. Those are for Tom. Don't eat the crawlers. But in all seriousness, it was just an amazing opportunity. And I was just going through the motions. I was a C-grade student. You know, I thought maybe I'll do this firefighter thing. I don't think I really had any real idea of what it would take to get there. And I was one of Tom's boys, I guess, at that point, because I went for the ride. They would talk about Tom would take somebody for the ride, and you'd have this serious discussion about where's your life going and what do you want to do. And we went for the ride. And he's like, well, have you ever thought about going to college? And I was like, well, Nobody in my family's got a degree. I don't really think I'm college. Maybe I'll go to Chemeketa. Maybe I'll do this. Maybe I didn't really have a plan. And he's like, well, why don't you check out WSU? And when you talk about like the most valuable resource in everybody's life, I think it's time. And you can't buy it. You can't loan it out. You can't barter it. You know, it's here and it's gone. And he took the time to take me up there. And Scott was in the program at the time. And I got to spend a weekend at WSU and see what a four-year campus was like, the WSU Fire Department, and just the opportunities are there. And I told him, I said, I don't have the grades. I'm never going to get in. And he pushed me. He said, well, then prove me wrong. Why don't you get a 3.5 for the rest of your high school days, and I'll write you a letter of recommendation, and you're going to get in. And that's what happened. So he pushed me, very similar to Serge's story. Like, I didn't really think I could get outside of this box, but he showed me that you can. And he really advocated for me to push for myself and become something that you think you're not. And he did that for everybody. Everybody had an opportunity. I remember getting sent through the search trailer. They'd smoke it out because firefighting conditions are zero visibility. And there was a person that was deaf. And he's like, let's try it. Let's see if this guy can do it. And the guy was doing it just fine, but we couldn't communicate, obviously. But he always tried to find a spot for somebody. If somebody wanted to be involved or learn or give to the community, he found a spot for them. So one funny thing I'll just leave on this is I've told you I got fired from drinking that chocolate milk. So I thought I was going to get fired here pretty soon because I washed his car for him. He used to have this Chevy Blazer, had an 8-track with a conversion of a cassette with John Denver in it. And I went for one of those scary rides too, with the Motorola cell phone block, driving with one knee, notepad, microphones. I washed his car all the time for him, wanted it to look good. He was heading to a meeting, and when the procession came down there at Parcel and they took the left turn, I could only imagine how he felt that day. I had washed his blazer, and he had told me, make sure the spare tire rack is latched tight. I'm like, got it, Chief. He took that turn, and the spare tire rack swung open, and it pulled the whole side of the blazer off, and it hit the ground, apparently. So he came back, like, really quickly after he left for a meeting. He came back, and he's like, hey, come over here. I want to show you something. I'm like, what's wrong? He's like, no, just come over here. He goes, remember I told you to latch that tire really tight? I'm like, yeah. He's like, did you do it? And I'm like, yeah, I did it. And he goes, and he's opened the spare tire rack, and as he opened it up, the whole side of the blazer, like, hits the ground, and I'm like, instant fear, like, I'm getting fired right now. This is it. I'm done. And just like most of you, I've always seen Tom with his glasses. He just kind of pulled them down over his nose, and he's like, next time, make sure the tire is latched tight. I'm like, yes, sir. And he's like, well, help me pick it up. So we get the blazer back up, and I don't remember if he had to do some wire ties or something, and off he went to his meeting. So anyways, I just really appreciate that Tom took the time for all of us, and Tom wouldn't have been Tom without all the family members that he has. His family is amazing people as well, so he had a big support system as well. So thank you to all the McDowell family, all the community members. Awesome opportunity. I wouldn't be where I am today without Tom and his guidance and everybody involved with the organization. Thank you.
Hello. My name is Jason Allen, formerly with the Seattle Fire Department, current CEO and owner of Ignition USA, where we design and manufacture tools, forcible entry for first responders. Serge, your speech really touched me because you and I have a very similar background. I'm going to do my best to get through this, but I'm going to stick to what I wrote. Like Serge, I'm not the best public speaker. I first met Tom on the road to Amboy. I was 16 years old and didn't understand the role that water played in traction when driving a vehicle. I wasn't as good of a driver taking those sharp corners like Tom. As I pulled myself from the wreckage of what was once my Chevy Cavalier, it was Tom that happened to be driving back from a meeting that stopped and helped me. Months later, my father came to my bedroom and said, the chief of the fire department is on the phone for you. Immediately, my mind began to race. What could I have possibly done wrong to have the chief of the fire department calling me? I remember Tom's soft-spoken voice on the other end of the phone asking how I was doing after my crash. It put me at ease, and I engaged in the conversation, and he asked if I was interested at a job with the firehouse. Little did I know that Tom had already singled me out to fill the position, and he was setting in motion the trajectory that would become my career and my life's calling. This is how Tom became a mentor to me. As I went about learning the trade, he never made me feel like he was watching over me or judging me. He believed in me, and he knew that no matter what he assigned, I could do the job, albeit sometimes with just a little bit of help. I didn't have the best home life growing up. Many factors led to me becoming homeless my senior year. I was sleeping in the parking lot of a high school, taking showers and washing my clothes in the football locker room before school, and then leaving so that it looked like I arrived just like everybody else. Tom noticed that something was wrong with me. And after some prying, I told him what my situation was. He offered me a residency at the firehouse. Many members following his leadership helped me in my time of need. Excuse me. This is how I began to see the fire department as a family and see it for what it really was and what it was meant, what it means to wear that badge. Because of their influence, I went on to become a paramedic and then to the Seattle Fire Department, where I became a tillerman on one of the busiest trucks in the city. It was during my time on Ladder 5 that I began my own company and started inventing tools to improve the fire service. It was because of Tom McDowell that I was able to do these things and that I was set onto the path that I am on today. Tom did many great things in his lifetime. He taught me so much and changed the course of my life simply by living what he believed. He believed in a kid from a bad environment and gave him a purpose. Because of the depth of his influence, I have named the newest tool in our line after him, the McDowell Wedge. I have no doubt that Tom would have some reservations about having it named after him. He was, after all, a humble man. It is my hope that this tool is used to make a difference in cities across the globe, affecting people in ways I can only imagine. I hope that those who use it will know the history of the tool and the man for which it is named. I hope that they will remember his legacy. His legacy is the people sitting in this room today and so many others that couldn't make it because they are out saving lives. I hope that they see that leadership, innovation, integrity, and kindness are the tools that will move the fire service forward. Because that is what Tom taught me. He touched many lives. He changed many lives. He was a great man. And I wouldn't be who I am today without him being the incredible person that he was. And I know that resonates with so many of you in this room. Thank you, Tom McDowell.
Well, can you hear me? Okay, I was born and raised in the north part of the county, and I remember the chicken coop because there was nothing. I remember one time the fire engine went out, and we could hear it. It sounded like an old calf bellowing because it was totally out of water. So I want to give you a perspective of a man who walked into a bump in the road, which was Yakult. Not a very good education. One time I went to a Red Cross meeting and I put on my Billy Bob teeth and I said, I'm from Yakult. Anyway, Tom came in and you have heard from each of these different people, but to see the beginning of him picking up these teenage boys and not giving him a job, but saying, I'm good at something. That was the most wonderful gift that Tom McDowell gave to the entire county. And having used his ambulance system, every time I get in, I think, thank you, Tom. Sometimes it's easier to get in than not. The one thing I want you to take home with you is not that he provided jobs, but that he provided people. The people that he made feel good are the people who make up the Yakult community. And at one point, I had written a grant to get a swimming pool at the fire hall so that he could have fire water training, because I know that we've had people that we lost in the river and so on and so forth. Well, we didn't receive the grant, but it was fun to put on paper what it was that he had done for the community. I have since heard that Lori and Sam Hummel have opened their pool for training, so maybe that grant was, after all, offered. And the best thing of all is we want to thank Diane and her family. Without you, we would not have had Tom. Thank you.
My name is Daniel Hopkins, and I was in my early 20s and worked with a friend of mine here that said, hey, there's a job openings at North Country. And he helped me with my resume, and I ended up interviewing with Tom and Ben Peeler for the job at North Country. So I spent the last 4.5 hours driving down here, and hearing everybody else just makes it a little more emotional. And as Serge said, Tom cared about people. I grew up in an abusive home, and Tom believed in me. For everybody that's worked for him and been around him, Tom believed in you. I was a resident at the station, and for 2 years, I got to work with some amazing people. First time I climbed Mount St. Helens was with Tom. And he toured us around to the different places for working with the VRT and Pine Creek Station. And we had some difficult calls at Pine Creek. And Tom came to me one day and said, we put you here for a reason. We believe in you and we believe in your skills. And a medic that I worked with here, TR, said that if you worked for one agency, you worked for one. And after leaving North Country, different places in the U.S. have saying that I've worked at North Country. There's been medics all over the U.S. that have started at North Country, or other EMTs that have started here. Tom has made an impact all over. And it was my honor to work with him and be part of the family. He was more of a dad than I had growing up, and he will be surely missed. And thank you, Diane.
My name is Scott Harlan, and let's see, when I was about 19 years old, I was trying to figure out what to do with myself. I thought, I'd go down to that station and volunteer, and I met Tom and Ben Peeler that day, and you know, Tom just impressed me as a very warm, nice, caring person, and so I was a volunteer for a couple years at District 13, and we kind of lived a little ways out from the station, so I couldn't always make it on every call, but I remember one particular time driving way faster than I should have, and finally got here just as the engine was leaving, and there was Tom and the excursion. He said, hop on in. And so I didn't know what kind of a driver he was, but I soon found out. But I enjoyed it, though. So then our family moved around a little bit and moved on over to District 10, and I told Ben, or I don't remember who I told first, but somehow Tom decided to have a word with me that I was moving to enemy territory, as he called it. But anyway, I had a good time over there at District 10. And then I was always, you know, trying to do things to make a living. And so I got my contractor's license, and I was doing various jobs for people, and Tom caught wind of that, and he's like, oh, hey, I got stuff for you to do. And so he started throwing all these little projects my way, and sometimes they came at just the right time during the rainy season when I needed something to do, and he just seemed to have a sense about him, you know, call at just the right time when I needed a job. Anyway, and then eventually went over, and he had a bunch of minor projects over at his house to do, and I felt real honored to work on their house. And people are always accusing me of spending way too long over there, but I was trying to do a good job and something worthy of the people that live there. And so I always had real fond memories of being over there and eating Diane's monster cookies that she would bring out every day. But I remember just getting to the end of one project one day, and Tom came out with a big smile and shook my hand, and he's like, this isn't goodbye, this is just see you later.
My name is Pavel Zabalotsky, or I go by Zabo for people that know me. Serge and I, we were in the same pod during the same time growing up. And so one thing that I was thinking about as I was flying here, I live in South Carolina right now, and I was thinking, well, what am I going to say? What do I want to say? And I started to think that, you know, Tom left an imprint on Yackel. But then I was like, wait, no, it's not just Yackel. It was Clark County. But then I started to grow further and further. And he really left an imprint in the whole United States and the world. Because there's people, I know there's people that live, I think at that time he lived in Australia. There was other people that lived all over the world where Tom has left an imprint in their heart. And so, as right now, I'm involved with teens. I use Tom's ways of getting to people. You know, I was intrigued how Tom's able to get to every person that he wanted to work with. As I work with teens and people that work with teens, you know, they get difficult sometimes. But I look back and I remember myself and how Tom dealt with me. And a perfect story that I remember, in fact, when Mike Williams was saying about going to the falls, I was driving with Tom. That was my first mission. That was my first time of getting introduced to Tom's driving as well. So, but a little bit what happened with when I joined. I was involved with VRT, EMS, and fire when I was here in Yackel. One thing that I've picked up from Tom, that he always, always found a way to get to a person and bring him that step further. I immigrated from Ukraine here, and I never thought I could have, you know, I wasn't able to speak English well. I wasn't able to do really, I grew up in a big family and never thought that I would have an opportunity. Never thought. But Tom put the American dream in me. And so when I became an American, I lived the American dream. And I still do. And I thank Tom for it. He brought me to be able to live the dream. One story I remember is when I went for the drive with Tom. As it was mentioned today, we were actually driving to a wildland fire in Spokane. So we had a long drive. He was hauling a trailer, and we were on the excursion. We were driving a long ways to Spokane from here. In fact, I missed my birthday party. That was the first time I didn't show up to a birthday party that I actually invited my friends, because it was a wildland fire, and Tom said, you're going. And so that's when Tom was talking to me, and he said, well, what do you plan to do with your life? What do you plan ahead? And I was like, well, I want to be, you know, I thought about being a medic, but I can't deal with the fact of pronouncing and dealing with death, you know, not necessarily pronouncing, because we don't pronounce, but having somebody die when I work on him, I just can't step over that. And so he kind of laughed and he said, well, this is how it works. And he knew I was a believer. And he said that, when a person has worked, when you work and you try to save a life and do everything you can, and that person ends up dying, it's not necessarily your fault. God's chosen to call that person. And I was like, man, I've been a believer all my life, but I've never thought that way. And in such a simple way, he made me step over that fear. And I graduated from OHSU OIT program as paramedic, and I was able to practice paramedicine because of his leadership. And so now that I'm a family man, I also want to thank Diane and David, Scott, Tammy. I want to thank you guys for Tom. I don't know if you know me as much as, I'm sure you heard about me, but this is going to be hard because not only that I see what he did, for all of us, I've noticed of perfect example of harvest, sowing and harvesting. When we stood up and said who was trained by Tom, there was a big crowd of us stood up, and I know that he missed some of your football practices. He didn't show up because he was in the community, not only here, but that has grown to a fruit. You could look at me, you could look at Serge, you could look at many others here, and we're able to affect, and we're able to touch other lives because of Tom's concepts. So thank you. Thank you for allowing Tom to be Tom and allowing him to touch my life, giving up your time. Thank you.
Well, on behalf of the family, I want to thank everybody for sharing all those stories. To echo on what Pavel said, as I look out at this group, I know that Tom touched all of us deeply in different ways. I look around at all the uniforms, all the people that have served or currently serving in public service in one form or another, and I cannot think of a single individual who either directly or, more importantly, through this community, indirectly, has saved tens of thousands of lives across the country, across the world. So that's what I'm reflecting on after what you just said, Pavel. So thank you for that. The family wanted me to pass on. I know there's more stories than we have time for, unfortunately, but to please continue sharing those stories. There's not a guest book, but as was already mentioned, there are guest book pages, so please fill these out. You can drop them off. The other thing, if you don't have the ability to do that today or you want to take some more time and reflect, there's a QR code on the back of the program. You can scan that. That takes you to tommcdowell.org. It's a website. It's a tribute to Tom. That's what the video has been streaming on today. There'll be more photos added and more memories added. So please continue to add to that. In closing out the reflections, I just like to offer my own personal reflection. Twenty-eight years ago, I met Tom, and I was looking to become a resident, and I showed up, and it was a VRT night, and I was just completely amazed. I was wowed. I'd grown up in Los Angeles, city of, concrete, stoplights, everything, crowds, but I was looking to come up here to go to paramedic school, And I'm watching this mountain rescue class, and I'm looking at changing careers, becoming a paramedic. And Tom kind of, you know, he invited me. And in the middle of it, he kind of nods, "Hey, come here, come over here." So I get up, and I kind of walk over, and he goes, "We're going to go for a ride." Notice the theme? But this wasn't the Code 3 lights and siren, steering wheel, pen, radio, scared for your life, can I drive for you, Tom, kind of ride. This was one of those Code 1 rides. And many of us have been on that with Tom, either literally or metaphorically. And we've all taken that ride with him. And in that ride, we had those heart-to-heart conversations. He asked those questions about where were you going with your life, what did you want to do. He prompted you, and he moved you to become a better person, to become a better human being. And I will be forever grateful for that. So in closing, I'd just like to say, you know, thank you to the family, and thank you for letting all of us share that ride with Tom.
Soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees, when I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. That God, his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on a cross, my burdens gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art.
We've had a marvelous celebration of life. I, too, was one of those who was a volunteer in a neighboring small community of Battleground, Washington. I was volunteering to be a chaplain, and I thought I needed to learn something about fire science before. Ken, my son, and I sat under your first responder class. Sorry we never finished it. But I did learn a lot in that process of time. And going to the various drills and so on, I'll never forget one time in a practice burn where we were up in an upstairs room waiting for the fire to engulf that room. I was the nozzle man and Dan Yeager was behind me on the hose, and he was instructing me, and I said, should I hit it now? And no, wait. He wanted to wait until the fire was over top of us. And then he said, okay, now, just one quick swipe of the water. And it was in a spray. And I learned what 1 square foot of water goes to, I think, 64 square feet of steam, and that's what put the fire out. And this place was smoky, and he said, I want you to go out to the engine. I said, yeah, right. I don't remember how I got in this house. And now it's full of smoke. How am I going to get out? And then it dawned on me, this hose I have in my hand is connected to the engine. And so I shuffled my feet around along it, went down the stairs, found my way out of the house. And when I got out of there, he asked me, he said, how did you find your way out? I said, I followed the hose. He said, don't you ever forget that. And when I think of that in a spiritual vein, where Jesus said to his disciples in John chapter 14, let not your hearts be troubled, for if you believe in God, believe also in me that in my Father's house are many mansions. I like the King James better than that. By the way, Tom built a lovely home, and I love wood, and that thing is wood everywhere. It's a beautiful home. I just moved into a brand new house that's a single story because my wife had a stroke 2 years ago. Really appreciated the paramedics that came out to help me with that whole situation and get her to the hospital. But I had to move into it, but I had to pay like it was a mansion, but it's not a mansion. And Jesus promised a wonderful place for those who put their faith and trust in him. And I'm so grateful for Thomas. He was kind of like I was in that upper room full of smoke. How in the world am I going to find my way out? And Thomas said, Lord, we don't know where it is you're going, so how can we know the way? And very simply, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. I'm that hose that's connected. You follow me. And that last song spoke about how Christ died on the cross so that we could have life eternal. On my uniform jacket, which I wear very seldom, I was amazed I could button it up today. I'm going to have to tell my wife I'm losing weight, and she'll have to do something about that. But I have crosses on there, and you see people with a necklace and a cross on it. Rarely do you, I've never seen one with a hangman's noose or an electric chair or some other form of capital punishment, but the cross has hope in it, doesn't it? And I can't help but think of that prayer of St. Francis of Assisi so long ago. I don't remember my physical birth, do you? I know a little bit about it. I watched the video that the fire department put on. In fact, I was in a home one time where there was an imminent birth, and we all got there. And all the firefighters that had seen the film, they wanted to be in the bedroom and watch this whole thing taking place. But there were also already two paramedics in there. And I told the guys, I said, here's a couple of kids. Watch over them. They don't need it. They'll call if they need any further help. And they were kind of bummed that they got out there, but they aren't able to see the whole process taking place. But I don't remember my birth. I do know enough about it to know that the walls come crashing in and you're being forced into through a canal that seems much too small. If you're not coming out fast enough, the doctor used to, at least, I don't know if they still do, they take the tongs and pull you out, cut off your food supply, hang you by your ankles and whap you on the backside so that you cry. Are you with me? And what's that little one thinking right about then? Everything was fine for 9 months. I got my food on time. I could do flips. I could kick my mother in the ribs. And all the above was just wonderful. It was warm temperature. Now I'm cold. The little one thinks they're dying. But when St. Francis wrote that wonderful prayer, Lord, make me I can't think of this prayer without thinking that we should put Tom on top of that. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there's hatred, let me sow love. Where there's injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there's darkness, light. Where there's sadness, joy. And where there's despair, hope. O Divine Master, grant that we might not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it's in giving that we receive. It's in pardoning that we ourselves are pardoned. And it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. As I understand Tom's last little while with mental confusion and all that went along with it. My father was 1 year older and also had that dread disease of Alzheimer's or dementia, whatever you call it. And as I sat beside his bed, the rest of the family had gone out to get a breath of fresh air. I said, I'm going to stay here with Dad. And it was during that time that he breathed his last. And I was thanking God for that. That he was no longer in a body that was messed up and having a difficult time. Tom was very active. Mike Williams was telling me that they'd be all night up on the mountain in a rescue situation, and he'd be a mess. He'd go home, take a shower. By 8 o'clock, he was back in the station with a clean shirt and ready to go for the day. That's the kind of man that goes beyond the call of duty. And that's what Jesus did for us, and give us hope for eternal life. For when we confess our sins and ask him to come and be our Savior, we have that place prepared, a place where there are no tears, no sorrow, no crying, no need for ambulances. By the way, in Battleground, we were all volunteers and used our personal vehicle, and they said that they would much rather that we got there in one piece and were able to help than to drive like Tom. No, they didn't. They didn't have that addendum to it. But up north here, you can do what you want, right? But I'm so grateful again for the hope that goes beyond this life. God has not promised skies always blue or flower-strewn pathways all our life through. God has not promised sun without rain, joy without sorrow, or peace without pain. God has not promised smooth roads and wide, swift, easy pathways needing no guide. He's not told us we will not bear many a burden, many a care, but God has promised strength for each day, rest for our labors, light for the way, grace for each trial, and help from above, unfailing sympathy, and undying love. I want to thank each of you for being a part of this time together. I find it interesting. One gentleman came all the way from the Carolinas, and he was probably escaping a hurricane or something back there, but nonetheless, he's here, and many of you have taken special time to be here, and what a tribute that is to Tom and to the family as well. I'm going to be closing this time in prayer, and then we have a thank you from Steve, and then we'll be listening to, we flew in Celine Dion to sing for us today as well. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, how grateful we are for life. Thank you for people who, because of their willingness to give of themselves, make a real tribute in the world and a difference in the world in which you have placed them. Tom was one of those. And we're going to miss him. And there's so much that will go on because of him. And we're grateful for that as well. Help all of us to think that way, that in the midst of our life, when our eulogy is being read, would be proud of the things they say, and that there would be the difference that we can make in life. So may the God who raised Jesus up from the dead, the God who gives hope, may he grant that and the comfort and the strength to Diane and the family that we all need at a time such as this. For it's in his name we pray. Amen.
On the behalf of the McDowell family, thank you all for coming here today, for everyone that's watching the live stream, to honor the life of Tom. The family asks that you take care of each other, treasure your time together, and as Diane said, be sure to get plenty of rest and catch up on your sleep, because Tom never did. And lastly, go in peace and cherish your memories of Tom. Thank you.
Let this be our prayer. Faith so well.